Hi, so today we'll be taking a look at how backend services can authenticate with a FHIR server using the Smart on FHIR framework. So if you don't know already, Smart on FHIR is a app launch framework that is proposed on top of FHIR in order to have a uniform mechanism of authentication. So be it backend services or web applications or your final end users, using these frameworks and this implementation guide, they'll be able to gain access to a FHIR server. So technically it's not limited to FHIR, but in the way it's defined right now, it is. And it heavily relies on OAuth 2. And I'll be going in depth regarding how your backend service, especially, so your own server, can authenticate with another FHIR server using Smart on FHIR. So if you take a look at if you take a look at the whole breakdown of what we have under Smart on FHIR, we first have the discovery. This is how we really discover what the server can do, this Smart on FHIR server can do. Then after that we have authorization. So authorization and authentication are kind of used interchangeably at times, but again, I'm not sure if they're using authorization here correctly. I think they are not, but authentication is the process through which you identify whether the person they're claiming to be is true or not. That's it. You just want to. So if I'm me, Sidharth, I'm going to a FHIR server. Authentication is the process through which the FHIR server knows for sure that it is Sidharth who's actually making the request. Now, authorization is a completely different concept. So authorization talks about, does Sidharth have access to these resources? So that is a more complex topic. And these are very two different things. And I don't think they've used it correctly in this website, because they mostly talk only about authentication, and only in the final scopes they really come about authorization. So we'll just consider all of this to be authentication, and we'll start about how your backend service can actually gain access to a FHIR server. So let's make it really simple. Let's have our own FHIR server here. So we have a FHIR server at ehr.com, and the discovery API tells that if you just query this particular URL through a GET request, you will get the discovery endpoint response. So this is an example response that I just got from the FHIR website. This you can check it out in actual servers also that support this. I think the Happy FHIR server supports that. So let's go all the way to discovery here, and let's go all the way down. So this is the full response. I don't want you to look at all of that. So just look at this for now. And there are two things that are very important that we will be using for authenticating our backend service. So one is the token endpoint, and the other is the registration endpoint. So we'll talk about the registration endpoint first. So the registration endpoint is where you go to the EHR and you tell, hey, I want to register my app. How do I do so? And the process will probably look something like this. You just enter the name of your app, enter other details they're asking you, which FHIR resources you want access to. And finally, once your application gets registered and gets approved, you might get one of two things. So one is you might get a secret key. So this approach, again, there are two ways in which you can authenticate. So one is the client secret basic, and the other is called the private key JWT. So I'm going to talk about both of these in detail. So the first we'll consider is client secret basic. That is also called symmetric authentication, because all you have is one secret key that is given by the EHR vendor, whoever you want to talk to. So using the secret key, what you do is you first make a post request to the token endpoint. So you have the client ID and you have the client secret, and you make a post request. Now, if you're already familiar with OAuth, you might see the familiarity to the client credential grant here, but if you have no idea about what OAuth is, that's completely fine too, because I'm going to take you through that, because the FHIR website doesn't really cover this particular flow that well. So the client credentials flow again, it's part of the OAuth spec. That's where the token endpoint and all these endpoints come from. So the token endpoint, what you do is you make a post request to the token endpoint and you say the content type is URL encoded form, and you need to tell the audience, you need to tell the grant type as client credentials. Now audience, whenever we talk about an audience, when we are talking about the client, right, in this case the application, our app making a request to some other FHIR server, the audience will be the FHIR server, the URL of the FHIR server. So in this case it will be https://ehr.com, so that will be the audience in this case. So the grant type would be client credential, the client ID, you just put in your client ID, client secret, you put in your client secret, and if all goes well, you'll get a 200 okay, and you'll get this JSON response. So once you get this JSON response, you have this token, you have the access token. That access token could be a JWT, it could be just a opaque token, doesn't matter. Now you then just use that token and make your future requests. That's it. So now you just send a request to get patient and it goes through. This is given that you already obtained permission to query the patient endpoint. So this is in the realm of authorization. So again, you need to tell the EHR server that, hey, my client needs access to these resources. And if that is done, you will get access to your resource. So that is about it for the client credential flow. So this is one of the flows through which a backend application can actually authenticate. The other flow is actually called an asymmetric flow, and this is where we saw in the capability statement, or I mean the discovery endpoint, we saw something to do with the JWT, right? So this is where that comes in. So here what you do is you register the application very similar to what we did in the first situation. You just say the name of your application, maybe a redirect URL if they ask you, and you also tell access to all the FHIR resources. Then instead of them giving you a secret key, instead of them giving you a secret client secret, they ask you to provide a public key, or they ask you to provide a public key URL. So now the point of this is that there is no common secret in this case. So that's why it's called asymmetric. So in that case, you both, the FHIR server and the client, had a shared secret, and that was the secret key. So in this case, you just give the public key, and when you're making a post request, you put in the JWT, which is signed using your private key, right? So again, this is how encryption works. If you want a primer on that. So you have a public key and you have a private key, and using your private key, you can sign and you can encrypt, and using the public key, they can verify and they can decrypt. So this is the basics of encryption, basically asymmetric encryption 101. So coming back to this asymmetric type of client authentication, how do we do that? How do we do this? So you again make a post request to the token endpoint and you send a JWT signed using the private key. So how do we really do that? Let's take a look. So going back to the backend services specification of the FHIR documentation. So they tell you here, again, this is very similar to this client assertion that we just did. So this is again the same flow. It's called the client credentials flow. I'm in the Auth0 website right now because they have a pretty good documentation on that. But all providers who provide OAuth will also support this mostly. So what you need to do is here in the grant type, instead of, so again, here it's grant type is still client credentials, but you need to provide another parameter called client assertion type. So the client assertion type here, it was just your ID and secret. But in this case, you need to first mention that you are using this particular assertion type. So they put in this big URN IETF blah, blah, blah thing here. And you need to use the exact same thing. You shouldn't change this when you're using it in your application. You're supposed to use the same exact parameter and same exact value. And here in the client assertion is where you put in your signed authentication JWT. So now let's take a look at how this JWT actually looks like and what we need to do. So here they are showing an example of how this flow looks like. And again, this is the full CURL command. And you can see they have a long token here, but they are making a post request to the token endpoint, and they are saying that it's a URL encoded form. And here you see the client credential, and here you can mention the scope and the client assertion type. This is just the URL encoded value of this. Okay, it's just a fixed value, and you just pass this in. And after this is the client assertion. So this is the JWT that's signed using your private key. So now we'll see how to actually sign this and how it works. Let's see if this is mentioned here. Nope, it's not mentioned here. Let's go back to our overview. And this is under the asymmetric authentication. And they tell you use something like this for the JWT header. And this KID is just a unique value that you come up with. So KID value identifier. So then you have a payload, right? So JWT consists of three things. So one is the header, the other is the body, and the other is the signature. So I'm just going to copy this full thing and I'm going to paste it in JWT.io and see what it actually contains. So the red part is the header, and it contains all of this. This is the signing algorithm, what they used. KID is the key ID. And again, this is the body. So now in the body, you are supposed to say which client this is for. And this is important because this is how the server can then verify if this JWT was actually meant for this particular app. So you need to put in a URL that you registered with your application. And the audience will be the actual token endpoint. So here in this case, it's authorize.smarthealthit.org/token. You can use the FHIR server that you are authorizing to. And the JTI, so again, they just put in a non-reusable JWT ID. You can put in any ID, a UUID will probably be a good idea here. And here, you also need to, you know, this is the signature. So right now in JWT.io, you can kind of verify the signature if you provide the public key and the private key, but we are not going to do that. So there are a lot of signing libraries out there, and you're just supposed to use your client's private key and using the SHA 384 hashing method and the RSA method. So that will be called the RS384 algorithm. You are supposed to sign this whole header and payload and put it in the signature. So again, if you're using a library that already handles JWT for you, this will be pretty easy. So after you have the JWT signed using the private key, you send that to the server. You get back a very similar response to what you got before. You have your access token and you have the type bearer. And now you have everything you need to make the request that you made before. And that's about it. These are the two methods through which SmartOnFHIR you can authorize and authenticate into a server. Again, I did that again. Authorize and authentication, not the same thing. I'm just authenticating right now. So yeah, so this was a very in-depth look at it. And you can also read the docs. So I'm going to put links to all of the websites that I visited, and you'll have access to all of them. And yeah, if you have any questions, let me know in the comments below. And thank you for watching. I'll see you again next time. And please subscribe for more content like this. The YouTube channel, I see most of you are still not subscribed. So please do subscribe. And we also have a newsletter. Go to medblocks.org and you can sign up to that email newsletter to be notified of any other content as well. So thanks again. Bye.